your brother. Face with hard luck. Face with hard luck.
Card shots, thieves, murderers with hard luck. Pimps and card shots, thieves, murderers with hard luck.
Your brother, face with hard luck. Face with hard luck.
Card shots, thieves, murderers with hard luck. Pimps and card shots, thieves, murderers with hard luck.
Good afternoon and welcome to the Hard Luck Show. I'm your certified, qualified West Side host, Steve Lucky Luciano. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, you've tuned into the greatest show on earth. It's the Hard Luck Show, coming at you from the virus bunker in Southern California today. Sitting across from me, my co-host and partner is
Chumahan Bowen, American Indian, Southern Californian. Elegant, barbarous. Come on, you know what this is.
If you living off the land,
yaksa-ya.
If you stick it to the man,
yaksa-ya.
If you die for your people,
yaksa-ya.
If you see through the evil,
yaksa-ya.
If you a storyteller,
yaksa-ya.
If you listen to your elders,
yaksa-ya.
If you speak your native tongue,
yaksa-ya.
We forever young.
Yeah.
That's right. What I'm talking about, I mean, that just sets the tone.
Well,
who
that's
is
it.
That? Who was
We're
it?
We're about to get into trouble.
That is Snotty Nose Rez Kids. That's Indian. That's American Indian rap.
Sean Lewis. Mr. Old Blue Eyes.
Sean Lewis certified.
Sound.
Audio professional. Engineer.
Yeah.
Oh. Hey.
Engineer.
Oh.
Ah. For the heart.
Hey.
Oh, blue eyes.
Look. Show.
Yeah. I grew up on this shit.
Yeah,
right
me
here.
Too.
That's what I'm talking about.
What? And
nine.
This is Sean. This is Sean's mood music when his wife's left to India and he's looking at the moon and he's alone with his son.
I see. You know what? I see Sean. This is Sean on a Sunday
right.
at about 4:30 in the afternoon, driving down PCH.
Eating pretzels.
He's in a Jeep, though.
Right.
And he's got his dog next to him in the passenger. Yep.
Yeah, and he got his son riding shotgun.
Yeah. His son's in the back seat.
Right.
In the baby seat.
They have a green smoothie or something.
Yeah. There's no wife anywhere around.
It's
Sean,
it's the
dog,
man.
And his boy.
That's
the man.
It's the man.
Yep.
Da, 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 da.
Real
you know
Southern,
what?
Let real me jiggy, bro.
Before
like
we
it.
Introduce our special guest, a real quick note. Sean.
Real quick disclaimer.
No, real quick warning. Everything you're about to hear is all opinion. We don't know anything for a fact.
That's right.
So don't try to come up here and try to sue us for defamation, motherfucker, because I'm an attorney and I will fucking bury your ass.
All right. You go.
So, Sean, dude, please continue the pretzel mood music. He said that he had discovered the best pretzels.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Well, where are they?
I know you're a pretzel fan.
Oh, yeah.
But I mean, I'm not saying
Come
it
on.
For that. Yeah, what is
where's
it? Dude, Split. This guy.
Where's it at?
Listen.
Shout out to Splits.
Splits?
Splits, yeah.
They're like real pretzels in the tiny form.
Okay.
So no, they're big.
Pretzel. How big?
Like, I mean, they're.
No,
they're
but they're
like
not the movie
across.
Fucking baseball game
oh,
size pretzel.
No.
Not soft pretzels.
But they're not a mini pretzel. Like
No.
Like you take a handful of them.
No, but
like
they're.
You take a handful of them.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, like you take a handful of them. A handful of this.
That little jack off motion just comes so natural to him.
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
But
that's
here's
his go to.
It's my go to.
Yeah.
All right.
It's mine too.
Listen, so these things, right? I was watching him eat them, right? And he was putting you to shame, Steve. He was just crunching.
Oh,
they're delicious.
Yeah.
And they were
I'm going to
so,
get you a bag.
Like, are you?
You were chewing them like a goddamn moose, huh?
I was kissing them, dude.
Yeah.
He kissed. Yeah, I'm not kidding you. He kissed.
They're that good.
He,
oh, bring them.
Because I go, are those good? And he's like, oh. And then he like took the little pretzel and he kissed it. He was like, oh. And I'm like, I've never seen Sean kiss anybody, let alone food.
It sounded like he was fucking busting a nut while he was eating them, huh?
Easily.
Well, I asked him, I'm like, what's the glaze on that?
did he suck the salt off first?
Yeah. No.
Does he suck the salt first?
No.
He tongues the tip of the salt before he bites it.
If you lick the salt off first, then you're going to have to, you know, get through a terrible pretzel. You got to leave the salt on there.
All right. So now
put mustard on it.
No mustard.
Get a little mustard first.
He's a purist. He's a purist. He's one of these guys. But so now you're hearing a special voice. I'm going to introduce a new guest we have. That's the wrong Star Wars thing.
I was gonna dance though. You know? Yeah.
His name. Just kidding.
What is right. that? For it's, people that want to know,
that is Star Wars main title by. Oh, so this is an artist named Cosmos, and Cosmos takes all orchestra stuff and turns it into electronica. And he uses, I think, like Atari sounds.
Look who's coming in. Come on.
Hold on. Here we go. Let me introduce this guest, right?
Oh. Yeah. Oh, shit.
Here we go.
Oh, what's up? Hold on.
Hold on.
That's your theme song walking in.
Here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, from the Death Star.
Yeah.
Right? Under no control of anybody. Right? Making motherfuckers choke just by looking at them.
With a cloud of smoke following every step.
We have the expert, the illustrious expert on all things vape, Dark Vaper.
Welcome to the Dark Vaper show. Thank you, man. But that ain't my song right there. You know what I'm saying, dog? I need something funky.
All right. Dark Vaper needs something funky.
Yeah.
Look at the crowd.
My words might hypnotize.
We got something funky right here.
Oh, we got something funky just limped into the fucking studio.
No, I mean funky music-wise, not funky odoriferous.
Oh, they love your funk!
Thank you, Dark Vapor!
Look at those ladies, they're shaking their titties.
Hey,
this man is a respected man of industries. Put your clothes back on.
Put your shirts down, ladies.
What are you doing?
Save that for later.
Security, can you please remove the boyfriends of the girls that just went topless? All right, thank you.
And funk is its own reward.
Funk is its own reward.
George Clinton.
All right, so let's go to what is your song then, because...
What's going on, people?
Quite frankly, I don't want any disrespect. You're a man of letters. You're a scholarly man, an athletic man. You have accomplished many things, and you're entitled to select your own music. And this is the selection you picked. Yeah!
There you go.
What? I didn't know you could dance like that. Yeah, Dark Vapor in the house.
Big fat motherfucker rapping like nobody's business, huh?
You know what? We had an interview with Chase Infinity, who is a producer and an artist himself, and he was telling us about the first time he was introduced to Biggie.
What?
Chase Infinity, remember?
Oh, yeah.
His cousin, I think, was the guy who brought him to the West Coast.
Oh, yeah, he was breaking his music out here. Bigger B. He was the one breaking his album when he first came out in 92.
You might not know this, but aside from being a master in the vape industry, Dark Vapor is also a musician and an artist himself.
Yeah.
Of some notoriety.
Are you a musician?
I play.
What do you play?
You know, wait. You know when a motherfucker says... And you ask him, are you a musician? And they go, I play.
Yeah,
that means he fucking is going to fucking
play. Same thing as if you ask somebody if they play pool and they're a pool shark.
Right.
Hey, you're not going to take all my, you play, you know, whatever. And they're like, I play.
Right. It's like on the courts when you talk to somebody. Nah, like,
I've been known to play a little ball.
You play basketball?
The ball around every now and then.
Back in the neighborhood a little bit.
Dunking on your ass.
Next thing you know, your pockets are all out.
Yeah.
But the reality is, guys who play know that their gift comes from somewhere else. They don't have to run around and try to broadcast everything they do and everything they are. Hey, the only reason I can play is because I work at it, right?
Listen,
I'm the baddest guy in the world. I do this. I've been all over
the
world.
And what you say, that's like the same thing with like martial, like being a fighter. Yeah. You know, it's the dudes that really know how to fuck, right?
Yeah.
They ain't busy trying to beat up people. And stuff. No. You know what I'm saying?
Bruce Lee movie, he's trying to tell him, like, hey, let's take the easy way out. Like, I'm trying to be a nice guy.
Don't fuck with me because you're going to get hurt.
Right. But the guys that don't know how to fight are the ones that are the loudest on the front end.
Sure.
Right?
Sure.
So Dark Vapor is a good, close, personal friend of mine. And the reason why I wanted him to come on, aside from the fact that he's got a great personality, he's got a great mouthpiece, I mean, some of what I talk and how I say things is you know, in part a little bit influenced by Dark Vaper. I've known this guy for, how long have I known you? It's been 15 years,
I would imagine.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Yeah, right. And great. You know, some of the same conversations that you and I've had in the past, Steve, where it wasn't for anyone's entertainment value except our own, and we're just having a good time in parking lots or wherever, mm-hmm. right? I've had similar ones with similar Mr. Vapor over here. Dr. Vapor, Dark Vapor.
Make sure you understand that when he says in the parking lot, we like weren't sitting in the car together.
We were standing
out talking.
In broad daylight, in front of witnesses.
Because we heard about different parking lot meetings with Chumahan. You know,
no one's jaw was sore.
No scuba diving.
No sausage.
We call him Chewy for a reason.
Chewy. Hey, let me ask you a question.
All right.
Oh, what were you going to do?
No, just start, roll it up while I find the right music for this.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah. I know the song already. I left my heart in San Francisco.
Look at now.
Fisherman's Wharf, where they got the sourdough.
No, listen. I've got his face when you said, I left my heart in San Francisco, already told me that he's not down with it. He felt like that was an affront.
Oh.
Okay. Right, but
here we go with
look
Brian.
At this, yeah.
Brian,
right, here we go.
Get
here
her we feelings go. Again. We didn't say
right San Francisco.
Like Brian didn't like that. Brian got mad at that. Brian didn't like that.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm being attacked here,
Sean. The microphone's attacking.
We got it, Sean. We got it.
Thank you.
He fixed it.
See, all right,
he's got skills. So I'm gonna play the intro song, and I want you to make the connection, Steve.
Okay.
Why? So, ladies and gentlemen, of course, as you know, friend, family.
Yeah, friend or foe.
Family of the show, long time, was producer of the Life or NorCal series, right?
Yep.
Right. If anyone gets that twisted, then you're fucked up, not us. It is Brian Scott, right? And I'm playing what I think is the right song for him this time.
Fucking, I can't wait.
And I want you to make the connection, Steve.
Am I sure? This is my show.
This is your song, Brian. Brian, come on, Brian.
This is it.
Come on, Brian.
I can't dance right now.
Right? What is this? What is this?
What song
Moose?
Is this? Footloose.
Why is that right for him?
Because this motherfucker's foot is loose and it's not tightening up anytime soon.
This motherfucker came
loose. One foot that just hangs out on his side. The thing's loose.
Obi-Wan bun foot. Yeah, foot loose. Hey, Brian, your foot is loose. We better go pick it up out of the street.
I'm never going to live this down.
Yeah. And he came limping in. Oh, limpy.
That's the other side.
That's the other knee. Now he's got the knee in the foot.
Oh, man.
He's looking for that special lady. Come on, everybody.
Brian, loose.
Foot loose. Fell out the window last night. Hit the ground. Now my foot's turned around, shattered my heel.
You got some talent over there.
Yeah.
Just Dark Vapor, just for a little background.
That was perfect.
Brian Scott, how long were you down for, Brian?
35 long years.
He was down for 35 long years on a hot one.
Very hot.
Not a planned at all
no,
hot
not
one.
Not at all.
Right. But he did the time, and he did it as a gentleman.
He took a long fall and started doing the army man crawl.
Oh, now you got talent too.
Yeah,
huh?
No, I'm listen, for two are you now. Kidding me? Fucking. hey, so Dark Vaper. So he goes through that whole ordeal.
Yeah.
Right? And he's a gentleman, and he does it the right way, and comes out with a good name, all that shit. Right?
Right.
I mean, that's a long time to be down, right? So then,
you think,
right?
Many of them didn't make it that way.
Most don't. Right. Most don't. So, and he told the story, and honestly, all of us when we first heard it, I mean, it got emotional. There was a little bit of a tear, and there was like mad respect. So then he gets out, right?
Right.
It wasn't supposed to happen, but it's happened, right? Chances of all chances, lightning in a bottle. And he gets out, and then before you know it, he's fucking around with chicks and
I shouldn't be messing with.
Doing stuff that he shouldn't be doing, right? On parole.
Yeah.
Okay. And one of the things that he shouldn't be doing, right? What did he say? What was he doing, Steve? What was
I don't know.
When he's in San Francisco just this last time, what was one of the things he shouldn't be doing?
Not go over 50 miles out of his jurisdiction.
And then after that, he was in his room.
Oh, he was doing some, there was some,
some things I should have been doing.
Methamphetamine use that you're not supposed to be doing.
Right.
Yeah, some things involved.
He got a second chance, but then he still was like, I'm going to sample some dried goods.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then
I relapsed after 4 years.
Okay.
No, but that makes sense.
All right.
That makes
it happens.
Yeah.
All right. So listen. And somehow in the confusion of the dry goods confusion, right?
Dry goods madness,
mm-hmm. He thinks his PO is just outside the door. So he's like, I gotta get out of here.
No, I saw him. They were outside the
door.
Yeah.
He saw him.
Oh, he saw him. Yeah.
They were coming in.
They were there. They really were there.
They weren't there, but
the shadow people.
The shadow people were there.
He looked through the spy hole and he was like, I gotta get out of here. He was like two stories up or something. So he thought, the best way, window. I'll just hang and drop.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
Makes sense.
Okay. Yeah. And he does, and just as he lets go, he realizes, you know what? Maybe this isn't the best idea.
It's a little bit high. That was a little bit high.
How many floors was that? He came to.
Yeah.
Right.
Midair.
On the way down.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so he grabs a little pipe,
I did.
Am I messing any of this up?
No, that's absolutely true.
It bends in his hand.
As he's going down.
So I let go because I didn't want my manager to realize I had gone out the window.
He's got a lot of mental calculations going.
Yeah.
And he lands on his feet like a cat, but unlike a cat, he shatters his heel.
Yeah, the movie. That's the movies. It doesn't happen like that in real life. Yeah.
You forgot to roll.
Yeah, I did. You couldn't roll. There's no such thing as rolling.
That's true. Then this guy's he lands in an alley, and he army crawls his way down the alley. He's dragging his body on his hands and knees. And he gets to the fucking street, and it's a nightclub, and he's telling the people I put up. And a transvestite is telling him, get up! It's only sprained. Walk it off.
It's not broken. Mind you, I'm crawling through.
He's like, can you call an ambulance? And they're like, get up and walk that off, sugar.
Yeah. So I called my own ambulance, and they came in about 5 minutes.
Right.
He rolled over on his back and started dialing the phone.
So ever since then, right, and somehow he stays out. He went through all of that, and somehow he's, okay, now he's relocated to the Southland. And here he is today.
Here I am.
That's the fucking funniest shit. There's a million other funny stories. But in any event, so that's why he's footloose, because he shattered his heel and he's still limping. Why are you limping now?
Well, I think it's has something to do with the compensating for my foot being, because I had surgery in January and couldn't walk for months.
Yeah.
And so when I started walking, I limped too much. I think it kind of strained my knee.
Yeah.
Right.
And now yesterday I tore it up, which is another crazy story.
Wait, what?
Well, yesterday it popped.
Your knee popped yesterday?
Yesterday.
What were you doing yesterday?
I was with a girl.
Did you pop your knee during sex?
I absolutely did.
Man.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
That's worth it, bro.
It was worth it.
Did you get to finish?
Absolutely not.
Did you get to finish?
No, I didn't.
Dude, that shit hurt so bad.
Damn.
So
he banged it on the steering wheel of the car in the middle of
Wait a second. Were you doing
it was on Sunset and Highland Park.
No, were you doing like reverse wheelbarrow or what were you doing?
No, it wasn't all. I was standing and she was laying on the bed. And it went out.
Oh, you was a bed in there.
Yeah,
there was a bed. You were stepping your game up, dog.
Yeah, it was a motel room.
Yeah,
her room.
Right, but was it because the last time Dark Vaper, Brian Scott, when we had maybe the, besides my wife, the hottest chick in the world.
Oh, that's right. God. Next right? to
nice
your wife.
Move. Right. Nice Rachel Sterling, mm-hmm. right, on the show, right, and Brian Scott was there, too. And during that time, you never heard a more romantic,
astute.
I was trying.
You were.
I didn't have the money for it. She made it very clear. I had everything but the money.
And his posture was perfect for that two hours. Are you kidding me?
He was the most gentleman you've ever met.
Yeah, right.
But she was telling a story about how her fans are always like, show me your tits. And like Brian was like, that's disgusting. That's sick. Who would do that? That would never happen with me.
Or no. Like, yeah, he beat her up, you know, and then he was like, what? I just don't understand. I've never laid a hand on a woman.
Right, exactly.
Doing all that good old school shit, dude.
Oh, yeah, dude. He was Don Juan.
All that shit, they just see right through.
Right. Meanwhile, 2 weeks later, he's popping his knee in a hotel room.
Yeah, punching old ladies in the face.
No.
Actually, a little Asian girl, 28-year-old Asian girl. A little cutie.
Yeah.
No, so let me ask you this.
Wow.
That's
you got a social security number on
it? Yeah, no, that's a Dark Vaper. Dark, that's how it was. He would be like, but by the way, I open car doors and I will order for you.
I am a gentleman.
Right, yeah, exactly. Right. I don't go for any of that shit. But by the way, I am well endowed. Remember that?
He did that.
You talked about this. I never said that. No, you didn't deny it.
I'm not going
to. And we had to stop you from pulling your pants down to show Kitty. He's like, hey, look at this thing.
Yeah.
Do you think my dad ever left me?
Did he? He's dude, it was disgusting because I go over there. I'm sitting there having this conversation with a lady who's been in Playboy, right, Kitty?
Yeah, yeah,
right.
Yeah.
So this is a real, this is a dime piece on a dime piece. And I go, except for my wife. And I go, listen, I go, and then Brian goes, hey, Kitty, do you like my watch? Do you like my new watch? And I look over, and he's got his dick out, and he's wrapped it around his wrist, and he's showing her.
Did he make this up at nighttime?
He said, look at my belt buckle. I just got a belt buckle. You like this
brand
belt buckle?
Belt buckle.
Fucking
hey. Those are the kind of conversations we had in the parking lot.
That's how we get back to that. But, so
now you need to tell Brian who Dark Vaper is.
Yeah, well, I was just
not met.
So you heard the introduction.
I did.
All right. So Dark Vaper, I don't even know if I want to lay it out or if I, because when we were talking, he let me know what he's up to now, and we've gone through everything, and I started asking him a lot of questions and everything, and he's just got this expertise in this world or some knowledge in some world and
a vape,
the world of vape.
Really?
Somewhat.
Right?
Do you know, have you ever heard of a company called Green Lane Distribution?
No.
Okay.
All right.
So I almost know everything except that.
Right.
I don't know that
one. Right. But so why don't you, how did you first get started in the vape industry? How did it actually start out?
It was accidental, completely accidental. I came from the music industry.
Right.
And after the music industry, I got involved because if you're a musician, nowadays you really can't make a whole lot of money playing an instrument.
Mm-hmm.
Because guys like Sean now are doing all the music on a little computer.
See, John, you fucked everything up for these
guys.
God
damn it.
Hey, I'm just telling
part of the problem is this guy right here.
He's
fucking doing shit on that fucking machine.
It's all his fault.
Yeah.
Okay. So, you know, I got into something that was really easy. Music is real precise. It's all about numbers. It's all about fractions. It's math. Mm-hmm. Strictly math.
Right.
And so I got into bookkeeping. And I started working for a bunch of different companies. And there's a couple of guys who I met in the same place that I met Chumahan, same place that some of us have been involved in.
Right.
And
the sober community.
The sober community.
And Steve, let me ask you, you have some experience. How big is vaping in the sober community?
Massive.
Right? I mean, didn't we just have Lepke on here? And he was talking about vape battles and sober livings.
A real demographic. It's a real specific, as far as I can see, there's a demographic to it, too.
What do you mean?
I mean, 18 to 25, this demographic there's some females in there, but males primarily. And it goes bigger than that, but I'm saying in the community and recovery that I've seen, 18 to 25, man, these young guys are just, and they all got the hand grenades.
Yeah, I got those
hand grenades. Like, they got real vape machines. I'm like, wow. And they're blowing long. Jesus. These clouds, forest fire. I'm like, I don't care what they say. That can't be good for you either.
Right. Well, everyone before they've done vape sees that and is like, that can't be good.
There's no way.
Right?
That much. Those size of clouds with that much density to them coming out of your lungs. I'm like, hell no. That shit's fucking killing these kids. It's got to be. Meanwhile, I smoke cigarettes and I'm trying to cut down constantly.
Yeah, right.
But And I'm vaping at the same time because I use the Juuls. You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
Because I can't carry a big heavy thing like that. I need something real small. But it's big in that.
So
community.
It's really funny you say that because the difference between those hand grenades and the Juul,
mm-hmm.
hand grenades are much more healthy for you than the Juul.
How so?
Well, first of all, the Juul uses salt nicotine.
What's salt nicotine?
Yeah.
really good. Salt nicotine versus, say, freebase nicotine. And don't get lost with the word freebase.
Dude, like free, Brian Stevens.
Anything that's freebase, I like.
I just got an erection. Brian Scott got an erection.
I don't know why they ever call that shit freebase anyway. There was nothing free about it. It was my house. It was my wife. Yeah, it was my family. They should have called it house base, white base. Wasn't nothing free about that shit.
Right.
But freebase nicotine, they take nicotine from a plant. They take out all the bullshit and then they just stick it in these vape guns and they use 3 milligrams, 6 milligrams, 9 milligrams per milliliter of juice to put the nicotine in. That's the quantity of, that's the percent of nicotine you're getting. In a Juul, you're getting anywhere from 25 to 50 to 75, let me just say it like this, percent nicotine.
So Juul's
and the salt nicotine, by the way, is way more addicting than freebase nicotine.
Holy shit!
Why do you think Juul's first thing was to get it in stores, get it in kids' hands where kids can conceal this shit in school?
Yeah,
they can keep it from their parents because there's not a lot of smoke coming out. But what they did, Marlboro did way back in the day, they got the kids hooked on it.
Right,
they got the kids 15 to 18 hooked on this stuff.
Right.
So by the time these kids turn 25, 30, 35, they don't mind spending 15, 20 bucks over and over. And Juul,
yeah,
it's really cool. It's disposable. Mm-hmm. So every time you finish one of those little pods, you throw it away. And what do?
Go get another one.
Go buy another one.
Right.
Absolutely. I paid attention and I've talked about it with different friends. And this is a couple years ago when it happened. But I just remember reading and seeing and diving into the whole Juul merger thing with $13 billion and they only gave up like 40% of their company and they bonus like the first 300 employees $1 million or some crazy shit.
Exactly.
And that got me diving deeper and deeper into what these guys were up to, how they saw this coming, what it is becoming right now, what it is and where it's going. And it was just kind of mind-blowing, bro. Mind-blowing, dude. One of the first things I thought of, Chumahan, was you when I thought about that, because I thought about, I've been involved from a peripheral on some pretty big deals.
Yeah.
But nothing, like, you know, I know some, okay, so anyways, when they were talking about a $13 billion merge deal with Philip Morris,
Altria,
who I don't know, like a higher level than like maybe Pepsi, Coca-Cola, that have the type of not only attorneys and teams and people, like to go up against that or to go sit down at the table with a company of that size,
right,
with that much history. And it's like you got to really, like, how many layers are to those deals, dude?
I'll just to tell you from as perspective, I got a client that I'm working with, and this client has a business, and this client has a corporation, and this client sort of like put this business together and got it up off its feet, okay, and then sold investments, okay? And this is the type of person that when you go to all this just fucking avalanche, this fucking diarrheic avalanche of like self-help entrepreneurial seminar shit that's out there, so a lot of it's good, but it makes it seem like everything's going to be so simple, and the reality is it's way more complex. This person sold investments, but they may or may not have registered with the SEC. They didn't realize that there's all these other regulations that go along with it. It's not just so simple as, you know, hey, I'm going to give you, you know, 10,000 shares of my company for blah, blah, blah. If you haven't made certain disclosures, if you haven't, no, or you haven't filed for an exemption and blah, 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 blah. So, and that's just a small mom and pop company that you still have to go through all those hurdles to make sure that in the end, somebody, you don't get fucked up in a lawsuit.
Right.
But in for something that is $12.8 billion,
mm-hmm,
that many entities, that many holding companies, because you're talking about Philip Morris, but Philip Morris also, right, is Altria.
Right.
Right? And none of us are really privy as to why the fuck did it go from Philip Morris to Altria? Like, what was the rationale there? And there was one. There's some egghead in a fucking suit who thought it all up and was like, you know what? We need to change the name of this the company because of tax, this, that, and we're doing shit in another country. We got foreign trusts over here and blah, blah, blah. Same reason why you're like, Google, why is all of a sudden now it wants to be called Alphabet? Like, what the fuck is that? Anyway, the point is, at a $12.6 billion deal like that, and with that many layers, bro, that's like more, you could make a living just doing the paperwork for the deal.
Hey, but you know something else to think about there is if it's a $12.8 billion deal, what happened that day when the guy at Altria said, you know what? We should make this deal with these guys. And it's going to cost us $12.8 billion. What made that make sense?
Well, that's a great question. Don't forget
to also add the part that we're not going to have controlling ownership. We're giving them that much for 40% of their company.
But you have to realize something else. At that time, not only did they realize the potential of this product.
Right.
But they also realized the smokers that they were losing to this product.
Absolutely. You can't beat them, join them.
Hey, wait. You know, I'm getting ready to lose 5%. 5% to us is like, oh, that's nothing. I still got 95%. But 5% to a company like that is $100 billion.
I think it was as simple as a math equation.
Exactly.
That the head guy could be like, it was probably in under 5 seconds.
Right.
Bro, we taking this much, we got that, that's 2% of our earnings, let's recoup it.
Hey, and make this an easy deal. I'm not going to go there and try to negotiate. Hey, man, I'm going to give you guys $13 billion. I was like, what?
And Juul wanted the distribution. They wanted Philip Morris's distribution. They wanted to be in. They knew that's what it would take to make sense.
How many relationships do you think Philip Morris has?
Dude, globally?
Walk
100 feet anywhere on the planet.
Yeah.
And you'll see a gas station or a liquor store.
Yeah.
That have cartons of Marlboros in their fucking.
Right.
No. Why don't you just walk into a game store in Japan? And they have all these games everywhere. On top of the games, they have loose Marlboro cigarettes for all these kids to smoke.
They start them off early, dude.
Yum. When I was in Japan in the 80s, man, we walk in there and there's Marlboro cigarettes on top of all these games. And kids just grab a cigarette and start puffing. Japan.
Man, I was China. When I was in Japan in 93 with Pauly B.
Pauly
B wanted to go by the emergency. He needed to get some cream. He hurt himself.
Okay.
And so we're in there, and I remember.
I feel like there's a story.
He hurt his knee.
Yeah, he hurt his knee. And I remember sitting in there, and he's waiting for a physician to see him, and we're smoking in the fucking hospital.
Oh, yeah.
You know, there's ashtrays everywhere. Doctors are coming
out. Right, you're like ash in the open wound of one of the patients.
It's crazy. Hey, yeah. Japan's like that.
No, yeah. I don't know if any of you guys are old enough to remember, but that's how America was.
I smoked on planes.
Oh, right? Dude, I smoked hash. We snorted. Yeah. I mean, dude,
oh, we did it all. Yeah, we did a little something on planes too. But
we did a lot of something on planes.
Yeah,
I'll tell you stories about that in another day.
Yeah,
I was smoking weed on every flight. I was smoking weed in the bathroom every time I flew somewhere, bro.
Not in the bathroom.
Oh.
At the seat, at your seat.
No, we had that. That's a Pauly B.
Oh, dude, it was
Pauly B story. On our first episode or second, it was a two-parter because it was so big. We had the notorious photographer Esteban Oreo, and you guys were talking about the first trip to Japan with the streetwear and all that shit.
Yep.
And Pauly B was on there, and they took a can in the back, and that was back when they had smoking was in the back of the plane, and then fresh air was in the front of the plane.
Yeah,
which that basically, was much later.
Right.
Get your fresh air.
Much later.
It wasn't even fresh air. It was just like recycled smoke air was in the front. That was when they had the little metal ashtrays in the fucking armrest.
Hell yeah.
Right? Okay. And he was hitting. They didn't have a pipe, so he had a
little cranberry juice can.
Yeah, and he smoked some weed or whatever in the back. And the people in the front, the stewardesses came back and was like, "Is something going on back here?" And they're like, "I don't know. Yeah, some wires are burning or something. I don't know. Whatever." That was on the plane to Japan.
Then Pauly B went to the bathroom, pulled a clove of fucking cocaine out of his ass, did a big line, came out of the bathroom. And bugging hit the floor. Yeah. Like, I don't feel so good.
Yeah.
We're getting new details to the story.
Right.
For another day, I will save this story.
Please,
about coming back from Arabia and all the way across. It was crazy. I'll tell you the story another day.
Give us one morsel, just a detail with no explanation.
Yeah.
To tickle the
just
ass.
To fuck these guys, these
listeners. Our listeners up. Tickle them with just one little morsel something. Was there what?
The morsel would be I was playing in a band. We were going around the world doing stuff. We were in Saudi Arabia. Holy the last fuck. Night we're leaving, one of the princes of Arabia had this big party for us at his palace. And he's just kind of soft guy who probably has spent a lot of time in prison on the wrong side of receiving. But he's like, he's chasing, running around the place looking for me, and I kept running from room to room trying to get away from that.
Jadil, Dr. Vader, what are you?
He finally corners me in his corner. I'm like, oh God, here it comes. I got to fight my way. And he goes, hey, look, I want you to take this to America with you. And he hands me a chunk of blonde Lebanese hash this big.
Yeah.
All right, leave it there. Leave it there.
I remember those days.
That's it, right?
Yeah.
All right.
Hey, the story is it gets
it made back. It made it back.
It might not have made it back.
No.
The cliffhanger is, did the blonde hash actually physically enter the land of the United States, or did it somehow disappear on the way back? We'll leave it there. Don't answer that, Dark Vapor.
Okay, you got it.
Okay.
So, Sean,
you're making facial motions. What are you thinking right now?
Well, we know it made it on the plane at least, but let's leave it there.
So what does that mean? This is Mr. Logic. Go ahead.
Because he said he was smoking on the plane, smoking hash on the plane.
So all right, you know what?
They couldn't smoke at all.
he knows how to ruin a cliffhanger, doesn't he?
He's got Asperger's, bro.
Asperger's. Look at his face. He's all mad. Don't get mad.
Don't get mad. We're playing with you.
That face he gives is like, man, fuck you guys.
I bet his theme song ain't the same theme song right now.
Yeah, he's like, oh, wait, I'm going to push stop on the record. Is it still recording? Sean, I'm sorry.
Sean, I'll tell you this.
He's like, why are you accusing
Sean
me? I would never
do. He got hit in the nose right now.
He gets so mad.
I'll tell you this.
He's got a better mad face than Brian even.
You know what?
Go ahead, Dark Vader.
No, but we did land in France to pick up more people. The plane did go up and it came back down.
All right.
Let's leave it there. There's a new cliffhanger.
All right. Sean, does that comport with your logic? Oh, shit. Man, I wish I could put a microphone in his head. Bro. I did.
Hey, dude, he's looking at help wanted right now.
He's looking for another job.
Studio engineer. I got to tell you something. I never see Sean make that face any other time than during the show when we do that. Yeah. Like, I've never, like, in regular life, when I'm like, hey, man, what's that? He's like, hey, that's cool, man. Blah, blah, blah. And it's normal, right? Mm. But then whenever we go, like, so what's the thing? And I go, man, why are you? He's like, well, we know he got on a plane. And I'm like, yeah. And then I go, you're fucking up the cliffhanger. And then we get that face. I've never. Sean, what? I can't put a microphone into your mind, but can you please just share, like, what is going on in there?
Yeah.
What's the face about?
Yeah.
No. That's the pursed lips.
Yeah.
He
looked like Dirty Harry right now.
He won't look us in the eyes right now. I think I got to let this go. Dude, Dark Vapor, I don't know how I get into this with him. He's like my best friend, and then all of a sudden it's like this. I don't know. Look, he's like, no, you're not my best friend.
Not right now, you're not.
Not even close, he said.
Next to your wife.
Yeah.
Best friend, next to my wife.
Are you kidding me? That's part of my body, my wife. All right.
Hey, but I'll tell you something. It was really funny. You were talking about how this vape game got into the rehab business, you know?
Yeah.
But it's really funny because it actually started in China. Mm-hmm. There was this doctor, Dr. Li, who smoked a bunch of cigarettes. I don't know if you ever smoked cigarettes in China, but they're horrible.
Right.
They're bad. It's like sawdust in them. They're not even trying to make them taste good. And this guy knows that he's killing himself, but he can't stop smoking. So he decides he wants to figure out a way to atomize nicotine so that he can ingest this without all the other carcinogens, all the other chemicals that are fucking him up. So this guy figures out a way to do this thing, and he atomizes nicotine. He starts vaping nicotine. It didn't have any flavors and stuff, but he was vaping, and it satisfied his urges. So he tried to sell this to the Chinese government. And, you know, China's a whole different culture than America and most of the rest of the world. And they're like, get the heck out of here. So he says, look, I'm going to use this, and I'm going to be okay. And he gives the secrets to doing this to some guys in Europe. The guys in Europe go, hey, this stuff can really be helpful to people who want to get off of smoking cigarettes.
Right.
So you'll realize that, like, in England, you find people who are 60, 70 years old vaping because they do it for a different – here we have – it's a culture. Mm-hmm. Like you said, it's a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle. It's the tattoos. It's the big clouds. But over there, they do this stuff actually because it's a healthy alternative to smoking.
Right.
So these guys are puffing – And it wasn't a big marketable thing. It was just something people were using. So
it was like an it was like doing better than what the gum and the patch was intended
exactly,
to do.
Exactly. So then it gets across the water, gets over like in the New York area, and guys are kind of vaping. They're starting to see a little market. Right. And they're like, man, we could probably sell some of this stuff. Well, in the meantime, guys are coming to California for rehab. Right. Where's the rehab capital of the world?
Right, Southern California.
New Porsche bleach.
Yeah, you know? That's right.
And if you heard me say new Porsche bleach, then you probably know who I am.
New Porsche bleach.
Yeah.
Hey,
yeah.
Man, they all drive new Porsches, and it's kind of...
Everybody's bleach.
It's not very much dark vapor.
Brian Scott might be the only white guy that wouldn't be able to fit in Newport Beach.
Why is that? So because you're not good.
What?
Teaching all good.
So, no. You know, what's going on here? What's going on here in Southern California at that time? Were all the guys around here were in rehab, they were all in the real estate business. They were selling loans. I don't know if you remember that.
Yeah, everybody mortgages.
Everybody had mortgages.
Adjustable rate mortgages. I was on a class action team on the adjustable rate mortgage shit. And I spent 7 years of my... That's how I learned the law. Cut my teeth suing what used to be Wachovia.
Right.
Right. All what was that other one? There was another one. I can't think of its name right now, but there was about five different major banks that eventually got subsumed into larger banks because they had this adjustable rate mortgage scam going on. And it was all based in Southern California.
So these guys are doing adjustable rate mortgages, making lots of money. The industry closes down. They go into refis.
Right.
They make a bunch of money. The industry closes down. So now they go into debt consolidation.
Right.
And these are guys who are sober 2-3 weeks, and they're making $20,000 a week.
Right.
And they're like, this is crazy. We're making... Well, that industry shuts down. In the meantime, some kid comes out of here and they're running around blowing little clouds.
Right.
And people are like, well, what is that? And if you realize, and you know it, most of this, the industry took off right here in Southern California in the rehabilitation sector. All these guys who are in rehab, all these guys in recovery are the guys who are the flag bearers of these big companies right now that are making all of this money.
Wow.
And they realize, man, we can make a bunch of money. We already have a built-in labor force.
Right.
I own a sober living. I got 10 guys that live here. You guys want a job? They jump into this industry, and they start just turning it into big cloud contest and who can make a flavor. I mean, it was out of freaking control, and they made so much money. And the amount of money it takes to make a bottle of juice is so freaking ridiculous. The bottles were selling for $15-$20.
Yeah.
It cost 75-80 cents to make a bottle.
They're
making it in their kitchen, dude, in their bathroom with squeeze bottles. They're taking little mustard bottles, filling them with this juice, shaking it up. And because... In vape, this is why when people talk about how unhealthy it is, my first realization of vape was I watched these kids blow these clouds. I said, you guys are fucking stupid. I will never do that shit. You got to be killing yourself.
Stop right there. Mm-hmm. Steve, have you ever had that sentiment? Like, you're like, I ain't never, this is your fucking kid. That can't be good for you, right?
Yeah. Yeah, with those hand grenades.
Yeah, I thought the same thing.
Yeah.
Sean, did you think that? Did you see vape?
No, I wasn't. I don't know what you're talking about. I wasn't paying attention.
Cliffhanger.
Oh, man. All right. I really pissed him off. I don't know. I'm sorry, Sean. Please. I'm sorry. Sean, whatever I did, man, come on.
Right on.
Hey, Sean.
This is going to take a minute.
You and I are still okay, though, right?
Yeah, we're good.
We're music guys, right? We're good. All right, cool.
That's fucked up.
Hey, and you and him are good.
I feel you.
Cause
he's gotten me a couple of times, bro. So sure. He's gotten me mad a couple of times. I got over it quickly, though, right?
That's true. That's true, Brian. You're a true mensch. You're a real buddy.
I had nothing to do with that, Sean.
True mensch.
Anyway, all right,
so now I'm in this recovery arena with people. And a couple of guys I was working with had a company.
Yeah.
And they were making this juice and making some money. I mean, at the time, it was pretty good money.
Yeah.
They were distributed by a company, and this is probably in 2012, 2013.
Yeah.
These guys are making some money, and they're going, hey, I need somebody to kind of keep books for us. And they invite me to come over once a month and do their books.
Right.
And I come over and look at them and go, man, this vape stuff is stupid. it's going to be crazy. You're killing people, but I'll keep your books because you're making money. I want to make sure you're okay.
Yeah.
And it began to grow, and they needed me to come in twice a month.
Yeah.
And after a while, they needed me to come in once a week. And then, like, I had to tell them, hey, guys, you need me a whole lot more than just this, but I'll tell you what, you can't afford me. So I'll take less money.
Right. Wait. So without going into those details.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, I hear you.
So then, okay, so at some point, you're watching the industry grow. It goes right. from bathtubs in the guy's house to now these people need to eventually have an actual office facility, space yeah. and yeah. facility. What goes into a vape facility? Like, what do you really need? If you're, because you're just, Steve, did you wrap your mind around the fact that it only costs 75 cents to make this shit, and then they're selling it at like $20 or whatever.
What's it made of? I had no idea that the markup was that. I didn't know that the markup was that.
It's got to be, right?
Yeah.
How expensive is like pure nicotine? Like, how do you buy that? Like, well, how does it come? Does it come in a liquid? Is it a powder?
It can come either way. You know, if you get it in a powder, it's going to be less expensive, but now you have to do the processing to add the chemicals to make this turn into a liquid.
Right.
Or you buy it in a liquid by gallons or by drums or by totes. A tote is like 250 gallons of
nicotine.
Poison. Or flavoring. Or see, and in vaping, there's only four ingredients in vape juice.
That's it? That's but it. How the fuck are they making, like, you know, flavors like police donut and fucking...
Police.
They do. They have that.
Really?
They do. They have that. And like strawberry shortcake.
Sure.
Okay. If there's only four ingredients, how's that?
The four ingredients are propylene glycol.
Which is, what is that?
Propylene glycol is something that we use to keep things from freezing. They'll use it in antifreeze.
Okay.
Know? They go, it's bad as an antifreeze. Well, it's a lot of things, but it's also, we use it when people are flying vegetables and fruit from South America to here.
Yeah.
You spray some propylene glycol on to keep it from freezing because it gets up way up high. It's cold. You don't want the stuff to freeze because it goes
bad, changes,
right?
It changes the fucking flavor.
They put it in a lot of different things. Nutribars. You know, different things that we eat every day. If you read the ingredients, propylene glycol is right on the label.
Shit.
Vegetable glycerin.
Which is what?
Vegetable glycerin is like vegetable oil that... What they use that for is they need something to take the molecules of the flavoring and have it condense with the with the propylene glycol, because that's how they make the vape. You're going to heat this stuff, and you need these two things to adhere so that the flavors can all mix. Otherwise, flavors will sit over here. Some other flavors will sit there, but you need something that's going to draw them all together.
Okay, so the vegetable glycerin is kind of like when you are making a vinaigrette. And when you don't shake the vinaigrette and you just let it sit there, the vinegar, the oil, and the spices all separate. And they exist separately. And you have to come by and shake it. The vegetable glycerin keeps it mixed.
There you go.
Right?
Vegetable glycerin, propylene glycol.
All right.
And then they add flavoring. And here's how you make your police donut. The flavoring that they use is all FDA-approved flavoring. It's the exact same flavoring that's in your Rockstar, that's in your candy, that's
Kool-Aid.
In your sweet tarts, in the Kool-Aid. It's in everything that we eat today. When you eat bread and it tastes like bread, that's only because they put flavoring in it. Otherwise, it would just taste like flour and water.
What do you think?
Crust of a pie.
Yeah.
You know how pie crust tastes?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's flavoring in there to make it taste like that.
See, what do you think about that? What are you hearing? Like, I mean, what I just got from Dark Vaper was that not just the vapes, but almost everything we're eating that you buy at the store that's packaged has actual added flavorings in it to make it taste like it's supposed to taste.
I believe the label. I think that after time and marketing and the dollars spent, they want to like really make sure you're getting Graham.
Exactly.
You're getting the Graham cracker this or the Graham cracker, and you're getting the fucking strawberry this.
What does Graham cracker taste like? Graham cracker, right?
Right.
Because they put
somewhere it tastes.
It's like got to taste like that. It has to taste like that.
Sean,
otherwise, it's not a Graham cracker.
Does that mean, Sean, that in the splits pretzel, that there is a pretzel flavoring in the splits?
Probably.
I guess.
Okay. Mm. Thank you. So the point of the matter.
The point of the matter.
The point of the matter is, though, Dark Vaper, I mean, but based on what you're saying, is it possible then that there's a lot of foods that we think we know what the flavor is, and actually it the real food itself never tasted like that, but sure. we don't know that sure. because...
That's exactly right. I travel a lot, and I go to a lot of different countries.
Right.
And I'll go places, and these guys go, oh, well, this is a lychee nut. And I'm going, I'll taste this thing, and I go, that's not a lychee nut.
Right.
Because I know what lychee tastes like here. I've eaten food. I've drank, you know, juice that has this flavor.
Right.
And I go over there, and I actually eat one of these pieces, and it's like, that's completely different.
That's crazy. I read a science fiction story once where someone from like 300 years ago came here today, and they said all the food was flavorless.
Isn't that funny?
They said all the food was flavorless, and that what they ate back then actually had way more flavor than what we're used to today.
That's true. I believe that to be true.
That's crazy, right?
Because we rely so much on the flavoring, on being able to, for expediency purposes. I'm good, thank you. Just to be able to make food that tastes is very tasty, right? You go into a restaurant, it
right.
always tastes the same.
Right.
Because they're buying products that have these flavorings in it.
Right.
You know, and with regard to vape, these kids or these grown-ups, whoever's making the flavors, and these are flavor artists is what they're called now.
Yeah.
These guys make things that taste exactly like sweet tarts.
Right.
Why? Because they use the exact same flavors that are used in making sweet tarts.
How do the flavor artists, how do they make money?
They make money by creating these flavors.
Yeah.
And they sell them to a company. Almost like making, what was that thing we were talking about? The not blue, but the other cigarette that...
Juul?
Making like a Juul and selling it to somebody else. You
right.
come up with the idea.
Right.
You put it together. And you go, hey, here's this flavor. And you go around, you try to sell it to different companies.
Wait, like a flavor artist then, does he have like a laboratory? Is he at home? Have you ever met any of these flavor artists?
you'd be amazed. These guys are extremely talented.
Right.
They have a palate. Some of these guys are or have been chefs. Some of these guys have been people who have made other ingredients for other foods. And now they've just turned their skills toward the vape game. There's some guys who, there's a cat named Randy, who you and I were talking about him.
Yeah.
The other day. This guy makes some, what they call, these flavors are so good that they're too tasty or too savory for the average Joe. He makes
Are you hearing that, Steve?
He makes a bourbon spice flavor. Now, none of us really know what bourbon, come on, we're not bourbon drinkers, but they're guys who are connoisseurs of bourbon.
They would know this.
They know this.
He could make like a single malt scotch flavored vape.
And it would taste just like single malt.
He could make a protein powder vape.
Dude, he could make, right, a Quest bar vape. Think about that.
He could make a peanut butter pretzel vape.
There's probably already peanut butter pretzel vape.
It's funny when they have these peanut butter pretzel vapes. When you vape it, you're vaping this thing. You're not eating anything.
Right.
You're vaping this. And it literally tastes so much. You can taste the salt. You can taste the peanut butter. He can make it taste like Jiffy or a Skippy peanut butter, you know? It's crazy. There was a company called Charlie's. Can I say it on there?
Yeah, you can
Charlie's
say that.
Chalk Dust. I was anti-vape. I would never vape, and I'll just taste this stuff. These guys came out with a flavor called Mr. Meringue, and it's supposed to be a lemon meringue pie. And I'm like, yeah, right, okay, whatever. Now, I say, okay, I'm going to try this thing.
Right, that's how it starts.
I tasted this. I just took it in, and I didn't take it into my lungs because I was afraid this vape was going to kill
me. Bill Clinton.
But I just put it in my mouth, swished it around a little bit, tasted it, and blew it out. And it tasted so much like a lemon meringue pie. That when I blew it out, my mind tasted the crust and told my body to start chewing because I had crust in my mouth.
You tried to eat the smoke.
I start chewing. I'm like, what? I couldn't believe it. You could taste the whipped cream. You could taste the lemon. You could taste the crust. You could taste the salt of the crust. It was unbelievable.
That's amazing.
And I said, okay, this is really stupid. So I start trying different flavors.
Right.
And you'll find out that there are a lot of guys who are flavor artists and there are a lot of guys who ain't.
Right.
You know, they got some boo-boo juice out there, and boo-boo juice is stuff that we know just ain't good.
amazing.
But it there's some Jews. There's some, actually some very amazing. Oh, yeah,
ladies and gentlemen, Brian Scott. Brian Scott.
I want to ask you something about the meringue.
Yeah.
Could that be part? Could that be part of your memory?
It's calling on your memory.
Yes,
it's a sense memory.
You're not really tasting it, but a lot of it's your memory.
What do you mean, just by them telling me it's Mr. Meringue or Slim Meringue?
Because you know what it tastes like, and you're like,
no, because I don't like lemon meringue pie.
No, that's not what I'm saying. But you know what meringue tastes like, so is that maybe part of your senses that are being recalled?
Well, I would imagine so, because do you know what sweet tarts taste like?
Yeah.
If you vape something, it tastes just like sweet tarts, whatever. They have red hots.
You want to know something? You know what? I'm going to even take it a level.
Do it.
Deeper.
Go ahead.
I would challenge that the vape juice is even truly the pretzel flavor.
It is.
I'm saying I challenge that. I'm saying, what if the flavor, it's simply a combination of chemicals that goes in that triggers you to have that taste.
Yeah, but that's, I think...
No. I hear that. I hear that. But here's the thing. Being a manufacturer and watching... See, because I knew this vape was wrong until I got into this manufacturing arena and I saw how it was made.
Mm-hmm.
When you make a lemon meringue pie, you're actually using lemon custard flavoring that goes into lemon custard. If you go into a store and buy lemon custard, you're also buying... a bitter lemon flavor. You're also buying a little lime to make the lemon flavor come out.
Yeah.
You're also buying a cookie dough crust. Right. You're also buying, what was that thing we were talking about?
Meringue.
Graham cracker.
Yeah, graham cracker.
You're also going to get meringue,
yeah,
a marshmallow to give it that little, and you mix all these things up to a specific formula. Mm. And if you do a different formula, it will not taste like that.
Right. You got a calibration. It's a calibration.
Oh, yeah. And you're asking, what
it's
do you
It's a
need?
Celebration.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Celebrate good times.
There you go. There's the musician.
Come on, Sean. Celebrate, dog.
Oh, he's cool with you. It's me he hates.
Hey, but what these guys do is...
He's like, I'm not saying anything. This motherfucking Chumahan's going
to
fucking...
What you need to manufacture this stuff is the ability to reproduce these formulas exactly every time. Right. Because if you don't, you're right. That lemon meringue that was lemon meringue yesterday, if you put too much lemon in it or too much lime in it or too much graham cracker in it, it's not going to taste like that. I wish it was as simple as chemicals that just tell you, hey, you smell a fart right now. And you go, boy, that smells really bad.
That's actually what happens at my house on a daily.
All the time.
Yeah.
Now, let me ask you another question.
Wait, before we go, because you brought up a good theoretical point and Dark Vaper is laying it out. And essentially, there's a point at which... You're both right, because the sense of flavor is in part a taste and a smell thing, right? All that is are certain chemicals, whether natural or you bought them from wherever, whether it's an orange from the tree or it's an orange from the from a bottle.
Right.
But all that is chemicals that are triggering sensations, whether it's artificial or natural. That's how smell and taste operate. You're smelling chemicals.
Right.
And then in your brain, it's presenting a color and a vibe.
Right.
Right. And so, even if, to your point, Brian, like, let's say, I think what you're trying to get at was like, well, wait a second. Maybe these are just invisible chemicals that are inert and have no actual value themselves, but they're playing notes in your brain that are firing off orange, firing off lemon. But what Dark Vapor's also saying is, yeah, that is what's happening because that's how you taste.
Exactly.
That's how you taste. You can't, your whole body is set up, and that's what these artificial flavorings are designed to do. And half of it is just distilling the actual thing. So when you think about artificial flavorings, a lot of times the first go-to for a lot of health, because Southern California is like also sort of a health nut place. Where vape starts is also the same place where health nut shit starts.
Right. That makes perfect sense.
Okay. Why? That's interesting.
Because the fucking... Come on, bro. Come on, bro.
What do you mean?
No, but what you're saying is exactly right, because these companies that these flavors are bought from, they have spent time reproducing the exact acidity, taste... The flavor of a lemon.
Right.
And there's five different companies that make it, but each juice requires a specific company. You've got Flavor Art, you've got Capella, you've got all these people who make flavorings.
Flavor Art, Capella. These are companies that just specialize in making shit taste like shit.
They only make flavors.
Right.
And they both make a great flavor.
Right.
But if you taste them, they're completely different.
Right.
So this flavor artist has gone through and he said, well, I want to put some grape in this. And they try Capella, they try Flavor Art, they try Perfumer's Apprentice. And they go, oh, this one right here is specific to the taste I'm trying to create.
Right.
And it's like you said, they're just mixing these chemicals together to reproduce that exact sensation that you had as a kid tasting a sweet tart.
Yeah. You know? And the story goes, right, Fanta sodas, right, was originally, I believe, a German company. And I believe around in World War II-ish, the Germans were trying to create, I can't remember where I read this, but I read it in one of these fucking, you know, like, what the health do we know or some bullshit like that. But the point of the matter is the German company that was trying to make chemical weapons were mixing all these different chemicals. One of the chemicals failed. Because it wasn't going to kill anybody right then and there, right? But there was the odor of grapes. There was the odor of grapes filled the laboratory. And from that, they started realizing that you could mix chemicals to make these flavorings. And the Fanta grape comes from that. The orange, the fucking strawberry, all that shit comes from, originally, at least that branch, comes from the Nazi attempt to make chemical warfare. And it's grown from whatever. Now we're in a place.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a wild story.
That's a true story. Wow. And I'll fucking back it up with some shit. I read it and I was like, well, that's crazy. So the point of the matter is, and I think now that might even explain why Fanta has like a South American a base. Because I think a lot of those Germans that were part of all that shit eventually went to South America and then they started doing. But the point of the matter is that so. These artificial flavors, you know, they are meant to trigger those sense memories, and they are. But you know, the thing I wanted to know from Dark Vaper about is, so then have so like Randy or these guys. So what do they do? Do they have like at what point? Because maybe it's so individual. Like maybe you yourself, Steve, is like mixing the flavors, right? And you taste something and you're like, oh, that tastes like carnitas. I'm going to make carnitas vape, right? But then you give it to Brian and Brian's like, that doesn't taste like carnitas. Mm. How do they get it to where it's actually going to taste like what it's going to taste to standardize or to enough? How do they know it's hitting everyone the same way?
What I've experienced is when you walk into one of these guys' labs or bedrooms or garage,
Right.
They have hundreds of little bottles, little samples of all these flavors.
Mm.
And it probably started off trial and error.
Mm-hmm.
But eventually, your skills begin to get honed. And you know, when these couple of flavors are put together, it makes this. There was a kid early on when I was working at this company. There was a kid who was a flavor artist for one of the biggest companies at the time. And he was sitting across the office in his little lab with all these bottles. And I said, hey, you know, I've been trying to find a really good cigar flavor. Where can I find a good cigar flavor?
That makes so much sense to me.
And the guy says, well, what kind of cigar do you want? I said, well, here, look, here, try this. And I gave him a cigar. I let him take a puff. And he took a puff. And he just looked up and he said, oh, that's blah, 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 blah. And he just rattled off this flavor. And I'm like, yeah, right. So he reaches in his little thing and pulls out these samples, moves aside, and reaches in the back and pulls out that little bottle that he had. He put on a little vape gun, and he said, here, try it. And it tasted exactly like the Cuban cigar that I was trying to emulate the flavor of.
Man, can you imagine having that much knowledge that you could reverse engineer the flavor? Sean. What does it mean to you that a guy would be that dialed into his taste sensories that he could taste things and tell you what chemicals and what proportion of chemicals go into making that up?
That's genius level.
Like, could you do that for a living? Would you do that?
I mean, if I knew how to do it, absolutely.
Right. I mean, think about it. Wouldn't that be a dream job? Your whole job, right? Well, you could you, Dark Vapor, could you make a living if you were like some kind of like savant, right? Like, let's say you couldn't keep a schedule. You were never going to be able to come in 9 to 5. That ain't ever going to be you. But without being trained anything, for the most part, somebody could hand you a spoon or a smoke or whatever.
Right.
And you could spit out what that artificial flavoring recipe is to the T. How much money could you make?
Well, not spitting out to a T. He just got in the arena of what this was. But Sean and I were talking about this before we all came in here.
Yeah.
We're talking about music.
Right.
And we both have history in music.
Right.
And I used to make a living with people who would send tapes from the East Coast that were hit records, and they wanted to make an extended version of this record.
Yeah.
They would send the tape out here, and I would reproduce their song.
I would play
all the instruments, drums, bass, guitar, keyboards, congas, whatever they did, and I would reproduce the song. We would make it sound exactly like their song. I had a drum set, and we would make my drums sound just like the drums that recorded that record. I played the bass. We would make the tone of the bass just like the one that recorded that record. I will copy their line, and now we can make an extended version. I can hear keyboards, and I know what keyboard that is. I know what patch that is, because that's something that's my gift.
All right, hold on.
You know what I'm saying? Wait. We have gifts. Some guys who are carpenters, you don't have to make a drawing for them to build this roof on your house, because they know what tools are necessary.
You ever seen some of them paisas that are doing the drywalling?
Exactly.
They don't even use fucking root, nothing, dude. Yeah. They just fucking cut, throw out a chalk line, and just rip that.
Exactly.
And they're nailing it in, and the shit fits perfect.
And their line is straight, too.
Yeah.
How do you make a straight line? I can't make a straight line.
Right.
Wait. Listen, there's a lot being said right now.
Have you ever seen a person draw? I can make stick figures like nobody. I make a face with a
I've seen Brian do stick figures.
But you see people draw shit, and you go, how do they do that?
Wait. I want to go back to something that you just said that's not related to vape, but it's related to music. That's more.
It's all the same to me.
Okay, I get it. So music, right, is sound waves creating an impression in your brain that's interpreted and turns into a sound, which is why some electronic sounds are getting closer and closer and being able to recreate what the actual sound is. And maybe it's an asymptote. Maybe it'll never get exactly, but it's going to get close enough where human perception is not going to be able to.
They already are.
All right. So, okay. That disclaimer for blah, blah, blah.
Right.
But what I want to know is, so if somebody sends you, like, really, tell me, like, how the fuck do you make your drum set somewhere in Newport Beach, how do you make that drum set match what you're hearing on the, what kind of things do you have to do? Do you have to put a carpet on top of the fucking head? Do you have to fucking, what do you got to do?
Well, there's all kind of things you got to do.
Well, tell me.
Well, okay. First of all, you have to listen to the attack of the drum.
Right. What does that mean?
Well, the attack is like you're hearing a, or you're hearing a tick, tick, you know?
Okay.
The attack.
All right.
So now I know whether I need to put a carpet or something or a piece of cotton on top of the drum.
Yeah.
Now you also have to tune the drum to sound like the other drum.
Right.
So you have to hear the note, the tone. Like, is that drum doo, doo, or is it doo, doo?
Right.
Same drum, same snare sound, but doo, doo. So if it's doo, well, I got to tune my drum to that. Now we got to go back and EQ the resonance of this. So now I got to listen to frequencies. I got to listen. So, I mean, there's a lot of things that go into it, but it's something that
there's layers to this shit.
Yeah.
Sean, is that when you're editing this show, are you going through all that? Are you listening to EQs and trying to fix the levels and remove, Lucky's chewing sounds and all that other kinds of? How does it go? How do you do it? Are you relating to this?
Yeah. I mean, I do a lot of like the compression and stuff for the show.
What is compression?
So when you guys talk a lot of sometimes like especially him, but you
Steve,
too.
Yeah.
Especially excited, Steve, because I'm pointing and you can't see it. But he'll go from da 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 and then he'll like yell like super loud. Hey, don't say it. Like a fucking spike. It spikes the fucking. So I gotta like smash that so it doesn't fucking murder people's ears.
Right.
And also, like, you know, people are listening, cars, and maybe the windows down or whatever.
Yeah.
So it can't be like too quiet.
Right.
You know what I mean? Right. So, I gotta smash that all down.
Right.
And then, you know.
But he does the same thing. He's got to put limiters on it. So,
right.
You know, there's a threshold. You can get only this loud.
Right.
But if you have everything too compressed, it will all sound like everything sounds like this. You know what I mean?
It's not dynamic.
You lose the emotion from it.
Right.
You know? So I'm listening with the snare drum, and I'm listening to how long does it resonate? What kind of reverb is on there?
Right.
You know, because now I got to listen to the reverb. Now we got to think about where is pan to. And there might be two or three snare drums in a single song.
Right.
So you got to go through it. But now, that's the snare drum.
Yeah.
But what's more important than the snare drum is the kick drum.
That's more important?
Oh, come on. Dude. Without the kick drum, that's the thing you feel.
Sean just nodded. Sean, yeah. You're nodding because? Why is that's the kick bass, drum?
Right? You could have a song with no snare drum and just have the kick drum.
And that would still be enough of a song.
That would be still enough.
But back in the day, we used to have a drum kit.
Right.
You move your feet to a kick drum.
Yeah.
You clap your hands to a snare drum.
Right. You know? Yeah.
And the thing that keeps the beat is the bass.
And then you pop your kneecap off to a chick.
Exactly.
Got it.
Sucking the mustard off of a pretzel.
That's right. Look at Brian finally woke up. Wake the fuck up. All right. So listen. What's the craziest vape flavors that you've come across? Or I don't want to say it like that because that implies an image that no one wants to see. What kind of vape flavors, not that you've come across, but that you've encountered?
Well, you know, it's funny. I like specific things. I like fruit or candy flavors.
Yeah.
You know, but everybody has whatever they like. There's a company that specializes in granola.
Get the fuck out of here.
I should have brought you a couple of boxes of them because I'll never vape it. But it tastes exactly like granola. And it's amazing that they do this. There's other companies that make candy, like the Nerds.
When I'm thinking about what you're talking about, I'm thinking about, like, I've eaten some Jelly Bellies, right? Which is kind of the same thing. They make some weird flavors, right. And it's fun. They went through this gross phase where they were like, okay, this is the vomit flavor of Jelly
Bellies. No, okay, here, the real flavor, the most intriguing flavor I've ever vaped in my life is green bean.
Mm. Wow.
Green bean is huge in China. It is the biggest vaping because their palate is completely different.
Right.
They like beans.
I'm out there and I had a waiter one day. He came into the table and he's like, hey, I vape too. And I asked him, my interpreter, well, ask him what he vapes. And the guy said, I like to vape rice. I'm like, rice?
Wow.
What does rice flavor taste like? Green bean is what they put in all the samples they send over here from China. It's the biggest thing out there because they're very health oriented. And they, dude, you vape this stuff, you say it's the worst shit I've ever tasted. About 3 days later, you're going, where's that green bean vape? I love this stuff.
Right. Has there ever been one that like, because sometimes jazz is like that, where you don't like the song right off the bat, and then like five listens in, you understand it, and now you can't get enough of it? Like a song, like, I don't know if you've ever, have you ever experienced that?
Sure.
Okay. Is there a vape flavor where when you hit it the first time, you're like, you know what, fuck this flavor. And then at some point, besides green bean, besides some point, you're like, man, that I want to taste that carpet fiber vape again. Like, is there one?
There was one. I like fruits and I like candy. It was this one company that put out this apple peach strawberry. And it's like, all right, that's kind of cool. It's whatever. And then they put it out in an ice version. And ice just means menthol. Now, I don't know about you light-skinned guys, but we brothers, man, back in the day, if it wasn't a Newport,
right,
it wasn't a cool mile, Salem, we weren't smoking, we weren't smoking that stuff.
Right.
And that ice, I mean, ice in vape was not, I'm not going for a menthol vape. Come on.
Right.
And to this day, the only thing I vape today is iced apple peach strawberry.
I love that. Wow. Steve, do you have a favorite vape flavor?
No, I don't. I mean, I vape the Juuls and I vape Virginia tobacco flavor. Because for me, and I say this to a lot of these young guys that are around, like, I don't want to taste cucumber all day long. Right. I don't want to taste pancake syrup all day long.
Right,
I don't
want
to taste bubblegum. That's like that's not my shit.
Right.
I'm not in the game to dazzle my taste buds.
Right,
That's just not my get down. I'm simply vaping to mimic the taste of a cigarette.
Right.
I'm addicted to not only the nicotine. I'm addicted to the smoke. I'm addicted to the hit. Tobacco.
You
the
like
hit,
that hit in your that. Chest. We know that.
And I like the but more than that, I like the flavor. I like that flavor of tobacco.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so that's what I'm getting from the vape. I don't need no cherry pie, right. pumpkin. I don't need, you guys keep all, oh,
right,
I'm
right,
trying
right.
to mimic. And if I could fucking get off the fucking Juul and all of it all together.
You would.
I would.
Hey, right. but that's the one thing that Juul did. Juul said, we're not going to go in here and chase after all these strawberry and peach flavors and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. We're targeting the smoker. And when they put that salt nicotine in it, there's three different salt nicotines. You have one called smooth.
Yeah.
One called hit.
Yeah.
And one called 50-50.
Give me the hit.
And the smooth, when you ingest that, and that's what you'll find in most of this flavored vape juice nowadays, because it enhances the flavor. You can inhale it, and you don't get that throat burner, that chest hit. Mm-hmm. But there's one called hit.
Yeah.
That they put in this Juul set. When you take it and you inhale it, when I inhaled cigarettes, it was that chest hit. You want to
kind of expand on it.
Yeah, you want to feel that little hit going down.
Yeah, right. Burn
a and they bit. Naturally, they literally
making me want to smoke. Right?
But that's what they did. They literally emulate that experience so that guys like you who just want that cigarette, but I don't want all the carcinogens that come with it. I don't want the tar, you know, I don't want the carbon monoxide. I don't want all that right. stuff. I just want to. Nice hit of nicotine.
Now, when you're saying, okay, I don't want the carcinogens and the this and the...
Yeah, car, let's get down okay. to it.
So, well, what are the things that come with vaping? Because vaping isn't just, oh, it's just a vape and there's no... Because, like, there's a set of shit that comes with vaping. Like I want to know what that is.
Oh,
like,
Blue Eyes, before we get to that, it's on your question. Because old Blue Eyes asked me off air, he's like, I'm like, do you have any questions for Dark Vapor? And his thing was like... Is it actually healthy or unhealthy? Like, what's the truth?
Yeah, and what's the data supposedly on what this has on what the health costs or risks are involved with this thing?
Well, according to what I've read, the American Medical Association, along with a bunch of other people, have said that this is 94% better than smoking.
Okay, stop right there.
The American Heart Association said that?
No, you have to remember, the American Heart Association is anti-vape.
Right.
The cancer guys are anti-vape.
Right.
The medical profession, especially when it comes to the Heart and Lung Association, the medical profession, when it comes to people getting cancer. See, because if people vape, far fewer people are going to get cancer.
Stop right there. Hold on a second.
One thing I want to say, though.
Yeah.
And if nobody's getting cancer...
They ain't getting paid.
How are we going to sell our chemo?
No, we know that.
You know?
Hold on. So the organization that said it's 94% better is what?
There are organizations, and I know that part of the study was the Heart and Lung Association.
Uh-huh.
I know that it was, What is that? There's another... You got to pull it up online because you just got to read stuff.
Right.
Because nobody's going to say, hey, this is totally healthy and totally free. Like, they're not going to tell you that drinking water in Indiana is totally healthy.
Right.
You know,
right.
They're not going to tell you that drinking water in California, which we know is pretty good, tap right. water, is a lot better than India.
Right.
They're not going to tell you this is healthy. You know, but I don't
just
know.
Wanna,
how's air?
I just want to cut in here and then. Brian Scott has got his eyes half closed and he's massaging his knee. I just looked over. I'm listening to Dark Vapor explain that essentially that it is a better alternative to cigarettes. And of course the cancer industry doesn't want to fucking, but as he's saying all this and you're asking questions, Steve, I look over at Brian Scott and he's like, eyes are closed. And he's like massaging his popped knee. It looks like he's rubbing down like a fucking giant bran muffin or something. I don't know.
He's probably thinking about what he didn't finish yesterday.
Yeah, he's like, I just texted
you. You were only watching one of that. One hand is to throw you off from what his other hand is doing.
No, actually she's Chinese. So I texted her and asked her about
how many times is he going to say that?
About what you said about the free
meeting. We even got out of the chair. Me and him got out of the chair and we were grabbing something. And I go, he goes, I really fucking love that. And I go, oh, yeah? I go, did you do it before or after you busted a nut? And he goes, I never got a there. Chance, dude.
Man. That's why his knee is swollen. He's got all that juice washed in his knee. You got to really any chance that you're going to be able to release that pressure?
You got any neighbors running around here? Let's see if we get some lady to help.
You know what? There is an Asian lady that works in this
right
building.
Across here. Oh,
she's not. She might be 58, and no, she might be pushing 200 pounds, but she's ready for you.
Yeah, yeah,
you
yeah,
ain't gonna you ain't gonna bust a kneecap on this one. not a sharp angle in that body. You go ahead. It's like fucking. It'll be like humping a waterbed. Don't worry about it.
You might bust her kneecap.
Too much.
If he can find a kneecap, I don't know.
Oh, man. Hey, but you know, I'm not saying like nobody in this world should ever say that vaping is a good thing.
Hold on, stop. You know, I'll say it. Vaping is a good thing. Go ahead.
But I'll tell you, the reason why is because I tell people all the time, if you don't vape, don't start.
Right.
Because this stuff is addicting.
Right. I tried to tell Sean that about pretzels. I said, if you don't eat pretzels, don't fucking start. Yeah. Next thing you know, he's kissing pretzels.
I got a gift.
Yeah. It's designed to be addicting. It's designed to be addicting just like smoking cigarettes, just like everything
You know what,
else.
Though? I got to tell you something. I got a theory. Okay, so how dangerous is, and I look, you're not a doctor. I'm not a doctor. So this is all just speculation and opinion. So we're not recommending it. Dr. Dark Vaper just blew a cloud that you couldn't even see through. Listen, how dangerous is actually nicotine itself?
Not.
God, you see like that?
See, yeah.
Is that true?
Yeah.
Isn't it a poison?
It's a poison if you get it on your skin in large doses. But ingesting it, that is not the cause of cancer.
Well, I didn't think it was. I mean, it's all the other thousands of chemicals that.
Right.
No. But listen, Brian, what you're saying makes sense because, yeah, everybody knows that nicotine, I think, was like a pesticide at some point. But at the same token, it's the amount. So alcohol, right? If you get too much alcohol, you're going to die.
Yeah.
Salt. If you get too much salt at one time, you will die. You can get poison.
If you do nicotine over a period of years, it's going to have some kind of effect.
I don't know.
Effect, I would.
I don't know.
I've not read any study that talks
about that. I
haven't
either.
All the studies I've seen have said that it is not the cause of diseases. These things that are in vape juice, and don't forget, I was the biggest skeptic coming into this thing.
Right.
You can't make me believe this.
It's true.
And the more I read it, the more I watched how we were making it, how companies make this product.
Yeah.
As opposed to other companies I've seen guys who just grab flavors and whatnot, just pour it in a bottle outside while they're cutting tiles, for the bathroom and getting dust in it. They don't care. They sell it because they can make money.
Tiles,
literally.
That's right.
I saw a guy do that.
Guy's changing the oil on his car while he's fixing up some bottles of juice.
They do that.
Listen.
How do you know?
Because think about all the weird shit you inhale during the day. Just going through your day.
You know what it sounded like when he told me bathtub, motherfucker.
I know exactly
garage.
What it sounded like.
Well, no, but it also sounded like the steroid game at one
right.
point in time.
Right.
A lot of steroids.
And the same guys.
And the alcohol game. Bathtub gin.
Yeah, all that.
A lot of the same guys in the business.
I was imagining that you would get vape juice. If people were making it into the bathtub, I was imagining that somebody would be looking at a bottle and see like a pube floating in and be like, what the fuck? Like, what the fuck is that?
Hey. I wonder, they should make a vape juice that has like vitamins in it too. At least when you're vaping, you can get something good.
Talking to old Blue Eyes and we came up with the concept of energy vape. Like, why not put, fucking taurine?
You already have one, huh?
All right. So we got a box of, what is that? Brian, read it.
CBD.
Put on your old man glasses and read it. Buy focals.
And is it really, do you get the CBD through it?
You get CBD through it.
Okay, that's amazing. Think about that.
Get on the mic.
There's no THC in this, right?
There's no THC in that
That doesn't affect you from the neck up. But it'll relax your body and give you some moves.
So I wonder if people...
You might not pop a fucking...
You'll go... Man, that thing's going to put you to sleep even faster. You're already halfway to sleep.
I wonder if you're on parole that you're allowed to use this.
Yeah. Jesus Christ.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm asking. That's a good question.
Yeah, I would imagine there's no THC. They say it's less than
0.03%.
He's already trying to
figure it out. He's going to put it in his eyes. He's going to drop it in his eyes.
You know what? I'm changing your name to...
You want to drop it in your eyes? Eyedropper?
I'm going to change your name to Borderline because you like to walk right up.
up. Well, I want to know because it's okay.
Oh, it boy,
I might try
and it's
it.
Like a strawberry
I've
CBD.
I've never smoked. I've never vaped. So I don't really know.
Yeah, that stuff smells good.
Yeah, but I'm just saying.
You can taste it. It doesn't. You can put stuff on your
fingers. Yeah, let me smell this. Okay,
I'm to understand something about the problem. When it comes to hemp and things like that, we know there's there. When it comes to law enforcement. They are completely
that kind of
snorting it like Rush.
To do with anything like that.
Right. So, I did Rush.
I don't know how.
I did do Rush once. I had it in high school.
Yeah.
I took it to class and I was fucking my cousin.
Fucking high all the
time. My cousin Tenny.
Bells ringing and shit up.
Listen, that's no lie. My cousin Tenny, who was the biggest fucking and most amazing drug alcohol addict I've ever seen in my life, right?
Really? Wow. That's a big statement.
No, this guy, listen, I got great. He's got an extra thick cranium.
Yeah.
His whole
that's
game.
That's what allowed him to be.
I'm telling you, we should do a Cousin Juul. This is how he talks. Cousin Juul, I'm up here in Alaska. I'm just fucking on this crab boat, and I just fucked the ugliest, horriblest, most disgusting fucking woman. I mean, she must have almost already had been balls between her legs, but still had a vagina. I don't care. You get so horny up there. I swear to God, that's him. I swear to God. Guy's been married to two Thai women. He lives in Thailand. The guy's out of control. This guy, I'm in middle school, right? And I'm like, whatever he's doing, I'm trying to figure out how to get some.
Yeah.
So he's got this little brown liquid bottle
with
some, it's like something also in it, right? Mm-hmm. And he's like, Cousin Juul, look, come here. And I'm like, what? And he loved fucking...
Experimenting on you?
He loved fucking showing me shit I ain't supposed to have, right? That was his whole get down, right? I smoked everything. So he goes, Cousin Juul. He's like, now listen, this is a bottle. It's called Rush. It's the new thing. You know, sometimes these girls, they put it in the corners at parties and you go and you smell and you get crazy or whatever. And he's like, all right. And I'm like, hey, can I have that? And he's like, yeah, go ahead. So I had a full bottle.
Right.
And I went to school and the whole day, class, whatever, man, in front of as many of the kids as I could, because this shit like, was blowing their mind, right? And I was like plugging one nostril and just inhaling this Rush. And I gotta tell you, bro, like I would get blurred vision.
Your ears are
same old nitrates, what it is.
Yeah,
is
exactly.
that what that is? Yeah, I exactly. didn't even know what it was, but I'm telling you, it was like doing like whippets almost, like but times 10.
That was the original.
I was just introduced to those, like Tiffany introduced me to those things.
Yeah, just last week.
He was gonna say
last
that.
Year.
And you know what? He asked Tiffany the same question he asked Dark Vaper.
You know,
hey, was that gonna show up on a drug test for my PL? Still, can I do that?
They're not. Yeah, I don't think they're legal.
Were they doing it with the cleaner? The dust cleaner shit?
No.
Oh, you're doing whipped cream?
Sean came in and he was hitting the fucking dust cleaner, but as a joke. Yeah. As a joke, don't
dust
give me.
Yeah,
but
I know people. Hey, there's people that are addicted to that shit, man.
I actually had someone that I work with that had to get off the shit.
What's in it?
That's not.
It's gotta be. It's gotta be an accelerant that's caused you to get high, right? Is that what you're after?
No, he was. Sean was joking.
He knows what it is, though, right?
Go ahead, Sean. Tell him.
What is it?
The duster?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I have no idea what's in
it. Oh, you don't? But people use it for the game.
And you want to know something about Rush?
Yeah.
Is that there was a point in time with where they sold it in places.
Yeah.
Different places that sold it. That they had to name it videotape head cleaner.
Right.
That was what was on the label. So you didn't have like Rush and locker room and now all that shit. It just said like it had this thing and it was like videotape cleaner. Like, that was how they had the packages in order to sell it to you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
To get by some rules.
To get by some rules, yeah.
Oh, man. But I got to tell you. Okay, so then
That's like bath salts.
Yeah, sure.
You know?
Yeah.
Dude, remember that?
People were fucking themselves up with that.
What
I don't know. But I never even got to see it, but I saw a lot of people that had done it.
I think it's part of the meth game. I think some of the stuff.
Is that
was that? I think that stuff is in meth now because.
Is that what led to the shattered heel?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Serious?
Bath salts and meth.
I don't know if it was bath salts, it was meth.
Because I was reading reports on the bath salts front where it was like cannibalism, you know, like there was guys getting so high they were eating each other.
Yeah. Chewing each other's face off.
Yeah.
It happened right here in Los Angeles.
Was that real?
That was a true
story. It was real. And it was legal. It's legal.
Not now, it's not.
Hey, they just changed the name to video head cleaner.
And what's that other shit? What's that other shit that's like the fake weed?
Spice.
Oh,
spice.
Yeah.
You know what? I was just thinking about that. Balducci was talking about that. He had to do a spice run for a while.
Yeah.
Remember that? Yeah, he was Sean. Yeah. He was telling us
he
about.
He would smoke like fucking eight fucking
things
spice
of spice
blunts,
because
yeah.
he had to pee. He had to piss in a cup.
Right.
Spice dangerous though. With spice people are.
Yeah, he would say he'd get fucked up.
People are having convulsions, but aren't they? They were.
I know, but what I love about Brian, I'm actually Steve. Hey, Dark Vaper, what do you think about this? Steve and I are working out a Christmas series, right? And one of them's going to be Christmas tales as told by Brian Scott. And we're going to dress
I'm
him
down
up
for that.
Yeah, we're going to dress him up like a prison, deer, like a prison Santa. Oh, like Rudolph, right? Yeah, with a red nose, and we're going to have him sit down and like just tell stories by a burning log
and
burning meth pipe or whatever, right?
That's a good. I like that. Let's do it.
Yeah. All right. Because I love when Brian's laughing, it's the grass. And then every once in a while, he pops in as the serious guy. And it's a shock. He's like, no, hey, but people, that could send you into convulsions.
And in the background, there'll be a little set of feet, like a little baby set of feet, all dirty on the bottom, rolling around like little Asian girl in the background.
Yeah, that's my elf.
We got to have the Asian girl.
My elf. Dirty feet.
Are you into Asians, Brian? Is that why you keep repeating it?
I am.
And why is that? What is it about
the
Asians? Don't give us that shit. Don't give us that shit.
He likes the complete opposite.
Were you in Vietnam?
No. No, I was before. It was too late. Thank
okay.
you. No, I dated an Asian girl in high school.
And then
half Asian, half Chinese, half white. And I think that's where it started.
And after that, you just got the flavor.
Ever since.
You got the fever.
Ever since I've had this thing about them.
Right. All right. Dark Vapor.
It's not just Asians, but Asians is a big part of it.
Nah, I've talked to you a million times, and this is the first time I've noticed that you keep throwing out that this chick's Chinese. Yeah, like three times. You keep like, by the way, did I tell you she was Chinese? Did I tell you she liked to smoke the rice vape?
It was relative to the conversation.
Did I tell you she liked to smoke the rice vape? All right.
She liked green bean.
She liked green bean. Did I tell you I showed her my green bean?
She loves green beans.
She likes yellow squash, if you understand what I'm saying.
Hey, she really loves that green bean, though.
She really loves this. See that? She. All right. So okay, and then there's a bunch of other stuff that you put on the table here, Dark Vapor, that you brought along. Brian, can you hobble over there and just tell?
No, I brought a lot of that for you because we were talking the other day about the packaging of it.
Yeah.
I was talking about how it originated. It used to come in these little glass bottles and. Nowadays they use this in CBD. They call them tinctures.
Right,
tinctures.
Right,
and it's really cool because the tinctures now, these new CBD companies are buying these little glass bottles, these little tinctures. They charge them like 45 cents a bottle, and they're like, "Yeah, I'm gonna fill it with CBD," and then they charge you $75-$80 for this thing. Right,
straight
out of Cali, babe.
But the bottle, I buy these things in China for like 7 cents a piece, you know, and then these guys sell them to these. We're going to make a bunch of money. They sell them for 45 cents.
Right.
It's a nice markup. You just sell volume.
Right.
They fill it up and they sell some, you know, it's all relative, man. The markup is stupid. But they started, vape started way back when, these little glass bottles with these little droppers. And you had to go through this whole thing.
Yeah.
Then they graduated into these little bullet bottles where you could turn around and squeeze it.
Right.
And now they have these things, and they're like commonly called Chubby Gorilla bottles.
Chubby Gorilla bottle?
There was a company called Chubby Gorilla marketed their put their name on the bottom of it.
Yeah.
And everybody's using them. So anyway, bottom line was I brought all this stuff so you could see the path that this vape, the marketing of this vape has gone in. And we were talking about the label, so I'm leaving that box with you so you can see everything you need to see on it.
Yep.
But let's just... Man, it's just, it's a strange game, man. It's a strange game.
Well, listen, you used to be known as Dark Skeptic. Now you're known as Dark Vapor.
Dark Vapor.
Yes.
And I wanna say, I think I've learned a lot about...
vaping.
And Brian Scott's sexual preferences.
Yes.
Okay.
Especially that.
Yeah. Always gonna bring that
we
to
learned
the
about taste buds, about recipes, about perfuming, about...
I'm seeing a friend of the show in the future here, a guy that can sit in on different
absolutely.
Shows and talk about stuff. He's a 100%. Cool dude.
Hey, and then I can be a personality. Then right now I've got to be Dark Vapor, but then I can really be like...
When we talk about other subjects...
I can be the little shit-talking...
100%.
Dude, 100%.
That's all we do.
Shit talk.
Shit talk. That's what we do.
But I'll tell you right now, I will never talk shit. on Sean because Sean.
Yeah, don't play that shit.
Dude, he doesn't.
Sean, right don't on. Play
that's
that
my
shit.
Boy, man.
Right on.
Well, aww. Well, gentlemen, listen.
Hey, man, thanks for having me here today, by the way, man. You
thank
guys,
you for coming,
you
man.
You guys are freaking fun,
and
man.
And thank you for educating us on this whole vape game.
Right.
Man, knowledge and, hey,
and I will you, never
if you,
vape.
If you don't vape, don't start.
I won't.
And be careful because they're going to use all the same medium to introduce THC to the world. And that's the next
another conversation.
The next wave, dude.
Yeah,
so
that's
careful.
Part two.
Be careful. Thank you,
listen,
man.
You guys heard it.
Dark Vaper, the
Dark
greatest
Vaper.
Of the great.
Woo! Thank you.
Thank you.
And like we do about this time, adios, amigos, from the Hard Rock Show.